Well, I said my name's Sharif Rasheed. I'm a former student here. I graduated, I think, in 2010. And I'll just tell you a little bit about myself right now. I work in Pittsburgh. I work at a halfway house. I'm a life skills counselor for drug and alcohol kids. We take kids between the ages of 13, I think 20 or something like that. But that's what I do. I do a lot of work in the community. Sit on a lot of boards, actually in the community, try to stop the violence in Pittsburgh. Because I don't know if a lot of you know, but in Pittsburgh, we actually broke our record last month with deaths of individuals. I think it was 76 deaths. So what I'm going to talk about today, I kind of just want to start by giving a brief history, I guess, of African-Americans, not African-Americans, Black Americans, and just start from there. So the first thing we want to talk about when we talk about Black Americans, we want to look at the Middle Passage. Just a raise of hand, how many people heard of the Middle Passage? Can you tell me what it is real quick? Yeah. I'm sorry. Right now.
Oh, right now.
That's a very great way to, I guess, to explain it, I guess, in basic form. But the first thing you want to look at is the dehumanizing of Black Americans at this time. You see, this was to the groundwork of what slavery actually became. Now, when we look at the Middle Passage, if you just want to limit to just a boat ride from Africa to America, we can look at the cultures, or look at the actions that went on during this boat ride, a lot of murders, a lot of rape. But the thing we typically don't learn about is the rebellions that happened on it. Now, you see in the movie Amistad, and you see about here about the rebellion, but it was deeper than that. It wasn't just one individual. It was a lot of individuals. A lot of kings and queens actually jumped off the boat because they had an understanding of what slavery was going to become in America. So this is the first time we began to see Africans being dehumanized, setting the groundwork for slavery, what slavery was to become. So when we get to America, the next thing we begin to see is the decivilizing of these people. You see, we were dehumanized before we were decivilized. Now, when we look at slavery and everything that went on during slavery, we have to look at the murder. We typically understand that there was a lot of lynchings during slavery, a lot of hanging. But we don't hear the stories about the forced incest. Yes, a man was forced to sleep with his child. A woman was forced to have an abortion, meaning she was strung up from a tree, had her belly cut, and the baby was ripped out when she was like around 8 months pregnant. We don't hear about being buried alive. We hear a lot about tarred and feathered. We don't hear about the genitals being cut off. You see, slavery was a very, very vicious act, but we kind of minimize it to something small. And it wasn't just about physically harming an individual. It was about breaking them down mentally. The goal of slavery, which a lot of people understand, is that it was to keep the body strong, but keep the mind weak. You can't make a slave, or you can't make an individual a slave just by breaking him down physically. You have to break him down mentally. So this is when we start to see something like the slave maker. You see, we hear about the slave trader, the individual that traded the slaves, the individual that brought the slaves. We hear about the slave owner, the individual that owned the slaves. But we don't hear too much about the slave maker. This is the person that taught you how to beat down a slave, or taught you how to break this person down psychologically. Now, a lot of people want to say, oh, well, Willie Lynch letters, and Willie Lynch this. Willie Lynch was actually a myth. There's no such thing as Willie Lynch. It's false. But it was based on the idea that was created by slave makers. You see, it just wasn't one person. It was many individuals who had racist ideology. So we look at what slavery did. You see, it stripped the African of his culture. It stripped the African of his name, of his traditions, of his culture. So what do you do when you strip these things from that individual? You start replacing it. You start replacing it with religion. You start replacing it with the name, and this is where we begin to see names like Wilson, Smith, and Johnson from people who are from Africa. See, these names were taken out and then replaced. The culture was taken out and then replaced. So when we look at the decivilizing and what it did, it forced a group of people to see themselves as heathens for the first time. It forced a group of Africans to see themselves not as Africans, but as beasts. To see themselves as individuals who swung from trees in Africa, even though that's false. But they started believing these ideologies. So what happens next after we make that transition out of slavery, or supposedly out of slavery? We start to see a lot of titles coming about. Negro. How many people have heard the word Negro? Do people understand the word Negro has no connection anywhere geographically? That is, Negro is actually short for Negroid, which is a group of individuals who have no civilization. But you typically hear black people refer to themselves as Negro at this time period. We also have to look at the term African American. You see, during slavery, you weren't allowed to have an African connection. Everything African was stripped from you. Everything that related to Africa was taken from you, and you were beaten if you tried to embrace your African culture. So where did African American come from? You stripped of everything African. But then they allowed you to call yourself African American. We have to understand that a lot of these terms were given to black Americans at this time. It wasn't something that they sat around and said, let's call ourselves Negro. No, you were called a Negro. Let's not sit around and call ourselves African American. No, you were called an African American. We can sit down and say that we've taken these terms. Even if you want to look at the argument that I can talk about later, nigga. You weren't given the word nigga, you was called a nigga. There's a difference. So when we start to see that these terms, we start to see caricatures that come about. And the first caricature that I kind of want to focus on is a coon character. Now, how do you ever heard the word coon? What's coon short for?
Raccoon? There you go.
It portrayed blacks as a subhuman creature, but portrayed blacks as being lazy and very childlike individuals, unequipped for freedom. You see, you weren't allowed to get educated when you were enslaved, but then you were blamed for not being educated. You were blamed for acting like a child, even though they beat you down to the point where you acted like a child, mentally. They didn't allow you to read or write. They didn't allow you to communicate in your natural tongue. You had to speak their language. And if you didn't communicate that language properly, you were beaten, sometimes murdered. See, during slavery, because that's actually when coon came about. Actually, it was before slavery and during slavery at that time. And it portrayed blacks as lazy, childlike people who needed a slave owner. They needed to be enslaved. So what came about after blacks were so-called free from slavery? Brute. And people have heard this character, Brute. Do you have an idea what it means? Or what it portrayed blacks as?
Brute? I have no idea.
All right. Well, it portrayed blacks as very violent, strong individuals. Terrifying. At this time, they were described as terrifying, helpless white women. The question we have to ask ourselves is two things. Why were they accused of terrifying helpless white women? And why after slavery were they accused of being very strong, beastly individuals? The first thing we have to understand, at this time period, the white woman was America's prized possession. You can see this movie, you can see this related back to the movie Birth of a Nation. How many people have seen Birth of a Nation? You seen it? I suggest that a lot of people watch that because it's a very powerful, I believe it's silent. Am I correct? It's a silent movie, yeah. And it has a lot of information if you learn how to read and just watch between the lines, because it has a powerful message in it. You see, but portraying blacks as these brute caricatures, portraying blacks as very negative beef, is a way to justify killings. You see, this is when we see an increase in lynchings, increase in lynch mobs, increase in killing of blacks. And this was done by creating this ideology that blacks are terrible, that blacks are violently strong. You see, they were bred to be strong during slavery. And this is one of the outcomes of, this is something that followed along with that whole ideology. Now I want to make a transition, just looking kind of at the South. The one thing we got to understand about the South is not the only place racism ever existed. It's not. Now, you had Jim Crow, which I'll get to later, but that wasn't, I believe, until 1942, around that time period. But racism existed in the North, too. It was just unspoken. It was just something people become accustomed to. Now, in the South, it was segregated, very much segregated, and it was out there. The image was out there that it was very segregated. But in the North, it was just as segregated, not more segregated. Now, I've heard this quote once that the only difference between racism in the South and racism in the North is that it was colder in the North. And that points true even today. When we look at the North, we see a lot of segregation. We see a lot of communities that are very segregated. Even if you want to look at areas like New York, which is very highly populated, very segregated in New York. Extremely. I was just there not too long ago, and you can see tension between different communities. If you just kind of talk to the people and you ask them questions about what's going on up there. Now, when we look at the South, the next thing that comes about to me is civil rights. And I think everybody has an understanding about what civil rights is. Now, just to raise the hand, what's something you typically learned during the civil rights movement? How you say your name?
Nicola.
Nicola. Sorry. What's something you typically hear about when you learn about the civil rights movement?
People trying to stand up to other people and getting arrested for it.
Okay. What about you, Dave? What do you typically learn about?
Sit-ins, things like that. Peaceful protests.
Which one?
Michael.
Which one is it?
Michael Tyler.
Go ahead.
It's kind of my favorite one out here. This is kind of what I said, but racism ended in 68. Mm-hmm. Like, that was it. Everyone, equality happened.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Kasani?
Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, a lot of those.
What about Melissa? What do you typically learn about during the civil rights era?
Abolition and Jim Crow.
Now, you see me, I've always been that person who's always been, I guess, a little radical, I guess, so I've always wanted to learn the other side of the argument. And in order to do that, you have to talk to people who were around at that time period. And there's only one side that's typically promoted with civil rights, and that is a very positive and a very powerful movement. But an individual I've met with, and it was actually a few individuals I met with, even some individuals in my family, that were around during the civil rights, because I have a lot of family from Alabama, and I have a lot of family from New York also, too. So I kind of get two different perspectives. But people don't typically tell you about how civil rights hurt a lot of individuals. How civil rights portrayed a lot of black males being weak. Because it wasn't just the powerful sit-in movements, but it was the question that was being asked. Why are you told to be nonviolent, but you're not? Why are you sitting down and getting beaten, and they're not? You see, now, violence is never the answer. But the question they had was, what's wrong with defending oneself? I think most people even today would not allow their child to be bullied. And that's what happened to a lot of black males at that time, and black individuals, even white individuals. They were bullied by power, a powerful system of racism. A lot of individuals that I spoke to also believed that civil rights was the wrong fight, that it should have been human rights. You see, we were dehumanized before we were decivilized. But we never achieved those human rights, or we never charged individuals with human rights violations. But when you're murdered, if people are raped, if people are killed viciously, your child's taken from you, your child's sometimes murdered, incest, child molestation, all things that went on during slavery, human rights violations. You only had a group of people talking about the human rights violations of black Americans at this time. A lot of people weren't talking about human rights violations other than your movements with, I think, your Nation of Islam movements, your Malcolm X movements, who always believed that we were dehumanized or we never achieved those human rights. Because when you look at what civil rights was fighting for at that time, a desegregated lunch counter. That's one of the main things, and people had a problem with that, or a desegregated bathroom, because it has to be deeper than that. It has to be taken a step further than that. Now we can believe in this ideology of cookie crumb progress, but when has that ever gave people the true freedom that they deserve? So we never failed, we never properly received, or we never accomplished winning those civil rights, those human rights. And we can see that even today, and I'll explain that what I mean by that later. You see, this is kind of like the birth, we'll kind of go back to slavery, kind of look at the birth of an idea of psychological enslavement. And how many people have heard the term psychological enslavement? What have you kind of a little bit heard about it?
Just that it's like kind of like a brainwashing to where you are able to get someone to think the way you want them to think.
Is it wrong?
Yeah. Isn't it kind of like making them feel like they need you in like a certain way?
That's part of it. Now, I'm kind of going to finish with the psychological statement, so I'll kind of give an example of it, I guess, a little bit. Psychological statement kind of goes back to what I said earlier. The goal of slavery is to keep the body strong and the mind weak. It keeps you very dependent on that person. It keeps you seeing yourself as a slave even though you don't realize that you are. It's a very, very powerful tool. Now people want to kind of relate to that conspiracy, well, I'm not a slave psychologically, but that's not the truth. When you look at statistics today, you will see that a lot of people do suffer from psychological enslavement. It's just not something we address. I work in a drug and alcohol field, you can see it. I sit down with kids, I was a counselor before I was a licensed counselor, and you see it. I talk to young individuals, they just don't realize it yet. But it's been passed down generation to generation. Now the next thing we want to look at is kind of desegregation and integration. And one of the most powerful things that kind of hurt the black community as a whole was the desegregation of schools and the integration of schools. I'm going to tell you why here. This is the easiest way to explain it. When you have integration, it should be a, this is kind of like a weird way to explain it, but it kind of, it's always made sense to me. When you have integration, you have A and C meet together in the middle and create B. That'd be integration, right? Two parties coming and create equality in the middle, meeting in the middle, integrating. But that's not what happened in America. This is what happened in America. You skipped over B and went here, and this probably moved there. That's integration in America. That's desegregation in America. We closed a lot of these black schools that were very established and very powerful at this time. We closed a lot of black-owned businesses and integrated them into white communities. We closed a lot of these schools because we didn't allow kids to go to schools that were all black because we believed, or they believed that the separate but equal wasn't equal for the individuals in that school. But a lot of those private schools that were all predominantly black were very powerful. And just letting a few in is not integration, nor is it progress. It's tokenism. When we see on the videos, when we see clips of three individuals going to a college or university, we want to consider that progress. But how is that progress? If every individual who qualified cannot go to that school, how is that progress? Progress for who? The two individuals that got to go to school, what about the 40 other individuals that applied and qualified that didn't get to go? The question I've always asked when I lecture is, did racism prevent true integration? What do you think, Rick? Just a yes or no. Because I'm going to ask everybody.
No.
So you don't think racism prevented true integration?
No.
Let me ask that question. Did racism prevent true integration?
Yes.
You sure?
I think so.
We'll come back to you later.
Yeah,
no? Okay. What's your name? Mark?
No, Mark.
What do you think?
That's not a question. I don't think so.
Okay. That's camera, right? Picture mute, right?
No.
You sure? We'll come back to you too. Melissa?
I say no.
Okay. Josephine?
Yes.
Amira? Mm-hmm. I'm terrible with names, sorry. Donika?
Donika.
Yes. Yes? I'm sorry. Jacqueline?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, there we go.
Definitely.
Nicole? Marcus?
Yeah.
Mary?
Block.
Alyssa.
Alyssa?
Yes.
Cassie?
Case?
What is it? How do you say your name?
My actual name is Ksenia.
Ksenia. What do you think?
Yeah.
Okay. She still can see his name. Crystal?
Yes.
Theo?
Yes.
Laura, we went to the bathroom. Journey? The corn?
Yes.
Okay, I'm terrible with names. I'm sorry. Dwayne?
Yeah.
Kai?
Yeah.
Elizabeth?
Yeah.
Celeste. So I got a friend, Celeste. I'm good on that one. Dan?
I think there's one other thing.
David?
No.
Matt?
Yes.
Nicola? Paul? Did racism prevent?
True integration.
Yeah, true integration. So I can't remember right from that. True integration.
Yeah.
Samantha?
Yes.
Sam?
Yes.
Casey?
Yes.
Mike?
No.
Now, my people who said no, raise your hand. Why?
Because I think to me, it wasn't just, I don't say it's just racism that being the issue, but it's because there's a little more behind it. So if you're saying it was just racism, I can agree with that. It was just racism.
Okay. David?
I don't think that it was just, yeah, exactly. It wasn't just racism that prevented it, but of course it was one of the parts, but I don't think that it was the only part.
Okay. You said no to reconciling?
Yeah, we just did.
Now,
I guess in a sense a little racism is to him, in some kind of way, but it's like it's not.
Did you say no more? Sir? Did you say no?
Yes, I
did.
Well, yes, racism still lingers. So,
just for the people who said no, I just want to. What's your definition of racism? Just real quick.
Pretty much to hate someone based on the social context of race.
Right.
Right.
Based on the judgment of your skin.
Now, the definition I've always believe was this definition in its truest original form, that one believes that his race is superior to any or all other. Now, it's okay to say no, and it's okay to say yes. There's no right or wrong answer to that question. It's just a question I think needs to be asked sometimes. See, do I believe that racism prevented true integration? No. I don't think true integration has ever happened in this country. True integration. And I think there's too many things that are in place that won't allow it to happen. I seriously think not acknowledging the power of slavery is one of the most powerful things that can prevent true integration. Because just by talking to little kids, and not little kids, but the youth, you see, you don't typically think that they're going to have an understanding of racism, or they don't even kind of acknowledge it, but a lot of them do. And it's not just Black kids or Hispanic kids or white kids. It's all kids. Different cultures, different races that have this idea about racism. You see, a lot of Black kids still believe that, I don't understand, when was we enslaved, or I can't believe we were enslaved. And then you have a lot of, this is just from kids that I've talked to and worked with, because I've always brought up the conversation of racism and slavery. And I've met a few white kids who asked the question, why did they allow themselves to be enslaved? And that kind of always put me in the middle, that it wasn't about people letting themselves be enslaved, or it wasn't about hearing this idea that Africans gave their people up, because that's not true. It's not black and white. It's actually a gray area, which is something I really try to stay away from, gray areas, because I don't like them. But it's just one of those cases where I believe in a gray area about integration. Thank you. So now I kind of want to move to education. Now, I think education is a very sensitive subject. Because as I brought up before, we talked about Brown versus Board of Education and how it ruled that you can't have separate but equal schools. At that time period, I disagreed. And that's why Brown versus Board of Education wasn't enforced until years later, well into the 60s and 70s. You see, a lot of these schools at this time period, when they were closed down, whether it's when I was using this by talking about integration, we talk about desegregation. A lot of these schools that closed down were predominantly black, were very established institutions. And the schools that kind of allowed some black kids to come in, because it wasn't all, it was some. And that's something we have to understand. Not all were allowed to come in, even though it was considered desegregated. But a lot of these schools, that's when you start to see a lot of these schools, charter schools start to come about. Now, I didn't learn this maybe until about a month ago, about charter schools. You see, they tied charter schools to the neighborhood. And if the neighborhood is predominantly white or all white, and the only people who can go to that school are all white. You see, there wasn't a lot of regulations and rules implemented on charter schools at this time. So a lot of the teachers who were very established teachers at that school went to these charter schools. This isn't something that's typically taught in schools. This isn't something that you can just, they can just open a textbook and find out. It actually took a lot of research to find that out. It's very hard. It was beneficial because I did a lot of reading. And it kind of opened my eyes to a lot of things. Now, how many people know where Black History Month started? Or what it started with, at least?
Started with, Black History Week?
Day first.
Day, yeah.
You know who did it?
Carter G.
Wilson. Good. Why don't you just tell us a little bit about that? Like, what was the purpose?
It was to promote awareness within, as far as different leaders who would come about. To recognize different leaders in the black community.
Now, what is it today?
So
go ahead, hold on. Go ahead.
I was going to say, well, how did it go from a day to a whole month?
There's a lot of BS involved with that whole trying to get it to become a month, honestly. Mm-hmm. And it was a lot of complaining, this isn't good enough, because it went from a day to a week, to a couple weeks, then to a month.
What is
Black History Month more today?
It's not, it's, I guess almost like it's like a celebration. It's not really like that you get so much knowledge and information about it. It's kind of like a celebration.
The celebration of Martin Luther King,
right.
Rosa Parks,
a few.
Civil Rights Movement, a few inventors. We always focus on the brother who came up with peanut butter. Because we all love peanut butter. But this is what it's become. At first it was awareness. Now it's become a celebration of a select few. Now there were many individuals who accomplished a lot. Not just Martin Luther King. Not just Rosa Parks. Now no knock to Rosa Parks, but she wasn't the first woman to not give up her seat. She just happened to be the lightest one. And I think that's a reality that a lot of people don't want to embrace. She was not the first. There was a young girl, I forget her name.
Lonnie Tunwood.
was in Claudette Colvin.
Claudette Colvin was one of the first ones. So that's, I think that's something that during Black History Month that should have been, you know, talked about. But my thing is, I think we need to get rid of Black History Month. And there's a reason why. If we want to be considered equal, or we want to be considered an equal society or integrated into a society, then why do we allow ourselves to be separate with a month? Because I don't care about the argument that it's the shortest month. I don't like the fact that it's separate from every other history. We don't call it White History Month. So why should we call it Black History Month? It should be American history. Go ahead, Rick.
I'm sorry. Okay, so do you think that it'll ever be a time where, you know, we fought so hard for Black History Month? Do you think it'll be a time to kind of say, okay, we don't want it anymore?
No. Because I think that a lot of people would even be afraid on a massive level to even have that discussion.
That's right.
Now, do I think...
Because then, how would it be talked about? Like, and then they probably just go away with it, period.
The argument should always be to integrate the history into American history, because it is American history.
Yeah.
It's not Black history, it's American history, because it starts off with what? What was the first thing we talked about?
The Middle Passage, slavery.
Slavery. That is American history. There was white individuals involved, there was Native Americans involved, there was Black Americans involved in slavery. That is American history. It is not just Black history. Because when you learn, even when you go throughout Black history, it does not typically start, it does not give you a very in-depth argument of slavery. It doesn't. It gives you some people were enslaved for a period of time. And then from there, we straight shot to civil rights. I don't know how you skip over everything about convict leasing. Now, how many people here have heard of convict leasing? You heard of everything. Explain what convict leasing is real quick.
It was when black men and women were sent to prison for basically trumped up charges, or they couldn't pay their rent, whatever, so they held them hostage basically off of a loan, and they basically took them to jail, and they were basically put back into slavery.
Do you know when that started?
Right after, I'm not sure. I thought it started just a little before slavery.
Late
40s.
Like 1860, I want to say 8, around that time period is when you start to see a lot of convict leasing come about. My dates might be off, but it's around that time period. You see, this is when you start to see groups like, or start to, even when you see books nowadays, Worse Than Slavery. How many people read that book? How many people seen that documentary? Y'all gotta read these books. But it's a documentary, but it does talk about convict leasing. And it talks about, now I just kind of want to just give some brief facts. When did America win its independence? What year? What was that?
1776.
When were black people first enslaved? 1619. That's when the first documented slave. So how many years before America even won its independence were black people enslaved? Close to 150. Now let's look at convict leasing, because that threw a lot of black people back into slavery. And that ended about 1942, around there. So what comes about in the 1940s? What do we see?
World War II.
In America. Jim Crow. Jim Crow went from the 40s to the 70s. Around there. So we have from 1619 until 1970, black people weren't allowed to, in many cases, vote, be free, receive a proper education, accumulate wealth for their family, marry whoever they please. You see, how many times have we heard that argument that, or heard the statement that you weren't a slave, so it doesn't affect you? It depends how you define slave. If people weren't actually free until the 70s, my father was born in the 50s. in Alabama. My mother was born in the 60s in New York City. Weren't allowed to have, weren't free. Groups like the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. I gotta say the whole name, because it wasn't just the Black Panther Party, it was the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. What was their purpose? To help the community by getting them tested for sickle cell, by making sure kids had a proper meal. But what were they considered in this country?
Terrorists.
Terrorists. The greatest threat to American society is the Black Panther Party. Now, did they defend themselves? Yes. But how is it that people trying to accumulate some type of wealth or some type of knowledge or awareness about oppression, terrorism? Also, when we look at the schools too, and I've said this many times, that we have to actually teach slavery. We have to stop moving away from the slavery, or moving away from slavery, being told that slavery was so long ago it's not even relevant. Slavery will always be relevant because it started this whole psychological enslavement. It started a lot of racism in this country. And if we fail to teach about that, then how can we move past that? If we fail to address the idea that the goal of slavery was to keep the body strong with the mind weak, then what do we do when we look at athletes? They didn't want you to be close to education. They wanted you to be more active and more energetic. They wanted you to be strong and dumb. So I've always believed in taking a look back at slavery. Now, there's a few articles that I want to... I've even heard Jada Williams, 13-year-old girl, wrote a piece on, I believe it was Frederick Douglass. How many people heard that story? This girl, she wrote, 13 years old, read the book, the Frederick Douglass book, A Slave Narrative, I believe it's called. The Narrative of the Life of Frederick Douglass, an American slave. And she just wrote analysis about that, how white teachers interact with black students. Nobody heard the story? So what happened to this girl is that she was considered very offensive, very disrespectful because she wrote this piece. And eventually was kicked out of the school for this piece because they feel like it offended her teachers. You see, there's many stories like that. Have you ever heard the story about the teacher in New Jersey who called her kids future convicts? And she's the one teaching these kids history. And you're labeling them as future convicts. I know you guys didn't talk about Bad Boys yet, did you?
That's what they read for today. So you can bring it up and read it for today.
How many people read that today? You can raise your hands a little higher. Now, how many people read that today? What are we talking about, Melissa? Just real quick. Okay. Is that okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Absolutely.
Well, I didn't read the whole thing. That's why my hand is on the back.
Oh.
just how black males are adults, seen as adults. So they, in media, have people thinking about this image of black adults. So, you know, and then when they're seen as an adult, as a kid, then, you know, there are people who know what they see in the media and so forth.
And that's kind of the whole idea that's being embraced by a lot of people. What time is class over?
12:20.
Okay. Good. That was over 12. All right, good. So it's this idea that black males, it goes back to this, what caricature kind of portrays that image that I talked about earlier? That portrays blacks as these very, you know, very aggressive individuals. There you go. I'm gonna whisper. You can say that loud. But it's this brute caricature that we even look at these black kids nowadays. We've kind of embraced these stereotypes. Black and white people have embraced these stereotypes. Because we're scared to go to certain neighborhoods and look at our own people. We're scared to go to to interact with these kids because we stereotype them. We have this idea in the back of their head that they're going to hurt us, that they're going to shoot us, that they're going to rob us. You see, we started embracing these caricatures a long time ago. We embrace so many different images about ourselves, whether it's black, we just embrace images about black people as a whole, that they are future convicts, that the only thing they're good at is playing sports, that if you don't move, as a bigot that said, if you don't have a, either you sling crack rock or you got a wicked jump shot, we embrace that stereotype even today. That we see the only way out of poverty, because the only thing we always attach poverty to black people somehow, that the only way out of these circumstances is either sports or illegal activity. Now moving forward, how many people have heard of the school to prison pipeline, that whole theory? School to prison pipeline? Kinda? Let's see what you kinda get.
Once they grow up, they have a higher chance of being at risk for this character, you say.
Mm-hmm. Now, with the school to prison pipeline is a lot of schools that are in, a lot of individuals that are in these like schools that are very poor. Very poor. The education is terrible, the teachers aren't qualified, the kids don't want to be there, they're not eating right. And it's a lot of these kids are kind of just starting here and ending in jail. I say we're miseducating future criminals because that's all we're doing. You have teachers like this teacher in New Jersey who's complaining about her classrooms being filled. You know what? You signed up for this when you wanted to teach in these certain areas. A lot of these kids are at high risk. A lot of these kids are in danger of going to prison, especially when they have teachers who consider them future convicts. Imagine being taught by somebody who thinks you're going to jail in a few years. Imagine being consequenced because a lot of schools have developed this zero tolerance, whether it's something major or minor, and being kicked out, suspended, expelled, and going back to the streets. You see, me personally, I grew up in the streets. People don't really typically see that because I wear a bow tie and fitted clothes. I've been shot at. I've had guns to my head. I've seen many friends die because of gang violence. I went to schools where teachers didn't give a damn. But how do you move past that? How do you educate kids, or how do you intervene with kids? Now, me, luckily, I had great parents who told me I'm either going to college or I'm going to college. There was no B. It was going to college, or you're already getting kicked out, so you're going to college. So that was the thing. But we have a lot of these kids who don't have parents like that who aren't around. We don't have a lot of these kids who have dreams of going to school because they're in schools that don't even promote education. They promote test taking. These are the schools that have these zero tolerance, that have probation officers in the schools, that have police officers in the school, metal detectors in the school, where these kids are going to school not learning, not paying attention, teachers not caring. Now, this is not to say all teachers don't care, because that would be a straight lie. Because a lot of these teachers do work harder than they need to make sure these kids have some type of equality or sense of equality. And I give those teachers the biggest props in the world, because I've met a lot of them. But this is to those teachers who kind of watch a documentary about schools and see how poor they are. And go into these schools very naive that they can fix the school, that they can fix these schools by snapping their fingers. You see, a lot of parents have moved away. This is true. And a lot of kids don't care to go to school or go to school. This is true. But there are 1 out of 20 that do. And if we aren't promoting education to that individual, or to all individuals, then who are we failing here? I know parents from working where I work, parents that pay their kids to go to school.
Now it's like an actual school system where students are actually attending school.
Really? Has anybody else ever heard that? Mm-hmm. You've heard it?
It's like in Cincinnati. freshmen get so much, and seniors kind of get the most for going.
For and doing good or just going?
I think it's just going to school. Just going to school.
See, I didn't hear about this. I don't know. I'm out in Pittsburgh somewhere. So I don't.
Yeah.
I guess it's a sign that I need to start moving on. But, so this is a lot of schools are failing. We are miseducating these, like I said, we're miseducating these future criminals. Now, I know this is a section that I guess people more like to get involved with because I play music. And I know everybody's heard this song.
Just press the pick mute again and bring it back up.
These niggas won't hold me back. I look in my fridge, my shit looking scarce. I got a few kids, we need some shit on the shelf. I get a knock at the door, they say my rent overdue. They want my niggas sell dope, and don't know what else to do. The only thing on my mind, I'm trying to keep on the lights. I call up my slime, I need a kilo tonight. Everything went well, I'm eating steak, no more soup. Then I pop the Capri, I went and got me a coupe. Everything takes time, but this shit came fast. Niggas standing in line, they wanna hold me back. I multiplied my hustle, stimulating my mind, motivating my niggas, and we never divide. No, these niggas won't hold me back. 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 These hoes won't hold me back.
Who's uncomfortable seeing his image? It was a question followed by that, but go ahead. I feel like you got something to say.
Oh, I'm just uncomfortable. One, he put a shirt on. I don't like it.
Who else is uncomfortable seeing his image? What?
Just the fact that, I mean, you see the houses and like this growth on them and stuff, and just the fact that they're like, basically, the music video is just the hood, and those like it's real.
Does anybody know where the video was shot? You know where the video was shot? The video was shot in New Orleans.
I knew you were gonna say that.
Anybody know where Rick Ross is from? Miami. So they picked out a neighborhood that is associated with crime to shoot a video like this, to where people dance to it and glorify these images. Does anybody know that BT banned this video originally? Yeah. They originally banned it, but then they worked it out. Because at first, you know, BT did something good, finally. Where they kind of took a step forward to that you're glorifying negative images, you're glorifying ignorance, you're glorifying oppression. And then it just flip-flopped. And this is what we see. You see, we gotta understand, who makes the final decision when it comes to the music industry about the music that's being played? The record labels, the A&Rs. The majority of A&Rs and the majority of owners of these record labels are not black. They would not be showing these images unless we were comfortable with these images. We have become very comfortable with these images to making the music that talks about this ignorance. You see, if you listen close enough, they're talking about oppression, this self-oppression. What's the song called? But what's he talking about? The song's called "They Can't Hold Me Back," but you're holding yourself back when you do stuff like this. You're not holding yourself back, you're holding your fans back. Like, the image you portray is so negative and so false. This is not the majority of Black America. This is not the majority. Like, you made money, millions of dollars, but yet you go down to one of the worst neighborhoods in New Orleans to film a music video? For what reason? Street cred? So what are kids doing now? They want to get street cred. They want to get fat and take off their shirt. And they see this image, they say, oh, this is cool. This is something I got to do. Like I always say, street cred, that extends to the end of your block. Doesn't go very far. So when I look at even BET, I think BET is one of the worst things on TV right now. But for a number of reasons. Before, you used to have information, news, and sources, and outlets. Now has ignorance followed by ignorance followed by more ignorance, topped off with ignorance. Okay, I'll say it again. Ignorance followed by ignorance followed by more ignorance, topped off with ignorance. There's nothing beneficial nowadays on BET because it all relates to this music industry that promotes this and says it's okay. Go ahead.
You had mentioned that the labeling company, So they want them to put that information. They want, because they say what goes and what doesn't go, right?
So it's the same thing with BET. See, everybody thinks that BET is owned by Black people, and it's not. Viacom.
So the people that's open, them won't.
So what's my thing? If you cut every educational channel, every educational informational show on BET, and you replace it with this, they don't do that on any other network. Goes back to the original purpose of slavery. Keep that body strong and that mind weak. Allow the oppression to continue. And I just gotta show this picture. Because I think this picture is very, I think you've seen this picture. If you can't see the colors, she is wearing a green dress. It's the same facial expression. Who are we supposed to believe this is a coincidence? But yet, this happens on a daily basis. We just don't choose to talk about it. But same hand though. And this is what I'm saying. These actions, this is all a trickle down from racism, because I think people don't truly understand the power of racism. It is not just something, just an idea that is, oh, okay, well, I think I'm better than you. But actually believe that you're better than somebody is very powerful because of the color of your skin. That we can treat people a certain way because of the color of their skin. But why do we glorify, or why do we just ignore stuff like this? It should have been a protest or something.
I saw this, I studied this picture when I was an undergrad, and like when I first saw it, I was just, you know, like literally I was just kind of like blown away. And
it's hard to look at once you find out what the original picture was. You see, I saw this image a long time ago, so when this came out, I knew. Because I try to study history, I try to, you know, make sure I know where we come from so I know not to go back there. And there's so many more things like this. NFL player in chains talking about Charles on chain, or shackle around his neck, shackles on his wrist. Possibly that's a coincidence too. That we relate a lot of these images or a lot of these black people to the brute caricature or a brute caricature. Oh, I'm sorry, Dan.
Do you think that the people that pose for these pictures, do they think far enough ahead to realize what they're doing? Or do you think it's all like post-production type stuff that is turns it into that? Or?
I can't speak for the people who took the photos or individual posts for it. But the only thing I can say about it is that I don't think it's a coincidence. I really don't. I think that a lot of people said, I want you to roar, look mean. I think that's true. Do they have this image in hand? I don't know. I wouldn't be surprised, though. But I can't speak on that. I can't say definitely that I know, so I'm going to stick to I don't know.
I've seen other covers, like magazine covers, and I think it was in your social theory. There were other, magazine covers that were not that different than this. And it just kind of makes me wonder, like, the celebrities or the models or the athletes that are posing for these things, do they realize the image that they're portraying? You know, because it just doesn't seem like, it doesn't seem like if you realize that, you really keep going on with it.
There's a lot of money in a dollar, you know what I'm saying? There's a lot of money to be made out there. Rick Ross knows that's ignorant, I guarantee it. He'll still do it. So I wouldn't be surprised if LeBron James knew, or he saw the picture. He probably just made a politically correct comment about it. I don't know. Now, I mentioned earlier with just psychological enslavement. See, I came up with something that I refer to as a cultural relapse. See, black Americans have failed to move past this ideology that we want to be free and have digressed back to we never were free with our actions. We embrace oppression. We embrace stereotypes. We promote stereotypes. You see, it's deeper than psychological enslavement. It's deeper than not knowing the history or not just being educated about slavery. We see ourselves a certain way. People see black Americans a certain way, and we allow it to happen. Now people want to say, oh, well, we had a Cosby on TV, maybe things would be better. You can't respect your way out of oppression. You can't polite your way out of oppression. You can't have a sit-down, non-violent mentality and think oppression is going to end or racism is going to stop. Are these all steps in the right direction?
Yes.
But we have Martin Luther King and Malcolm X who spoke about oppression and inequality. Look where we're at today. Look at Chicago. How many people have died in Chicago already? Over 200. But we're not talking about that on a massive level because we become so numb to these atrocities. We're not surprised. We're not shocked anymore. When you hear a story about, oh, my friend got shot, or I grew up with that kid, he got shot, are you truly surprised? Did you say, I didn't see that coming? You can't. Because we embrace these things. We embrace this thing and call it a culture. And call it part of, this is part of the hip-hop culture. No, it's not. What was the basis of hip-hop? What was the original purpose of hip-hop? Entertainment, talk about oppression, kind of get your voice out there. What did hip-hop become? Self-hate, ignorance, glorification, and a way to make money. People understand, most of these rappers are broke. A lot of rappers talking about, I ain't go to school, I was out on the block hustling. most of these people went to college. But don't portray that image. It's cool to be dumb and ignorant rather than be intelligent. We don't portray that image that I went to college. We don't portray that image that I graduated high school top of my class. No, we rather sit back and say that it's cool to be dumb. It's beneficial to the culture to portray myself a certain way. To whereas you can have an artist that gets on TV and says some of the most ignorant comments you've ever heard in your life. But we sit back and say there's nothing wrong with that. Now, moving forward, what do we do? How do you end oppression, or how do you break the chains of psychological enslavement, or how do you kind of become culturally sober again? Because if I said that it's a cultural relapse, then we gotta become sober again. We gotta be clean. How do we do that? Where do we go next? It's about moving forward. It's about stop embracing this oppression. It's about trying to create change in your neighborhood, yourself. Recognize the need for change and actually being that change. Now, I speak about change a lot, and I'm also in the process of starting a nonprofit called Be the One Change, where we do kind of talk about, or do kind of help the youth try to create change in their neighborhood, whether it's small or big, because change is needed. We can't just sit back, continue to be numb, and be silent. Writing is not being silent. Talking to one person is not being silent. Holding yourself accountable is not being silent. But sitting there, continue to be numb to it, is going to be continue to be silent. And we can't improve if we don't want to get sober and clean and break these chains. We can't improve if we just want to sit back and just hear somebody like me come talk to you once in a blue moon. The knowledge is out there, the knowledge is in the books. The knowledge is right here if you just read between, or you just see between the lines of the videos. This is ignorance. We can't allow stuff like this to continue to happen. It's not about a boycott. It's just a massive stop. Don't just boycott with the goal of saying we just want to bring some change, just stop it. That's it. We can't. This cookie crumb steps, or this baby steps, has got us to this point. Now, a lot of people want to think that this point isn't that bad, but it really is. Schools, a lot of schools are worse off than they were before. So many deaths, so many crimes, so many black people in prison, so many black people on drugs. Hey. Questions?
I hear I hear a lot of what you're saying applying to people of color, as far as like this image, portraying this image of self-hatred and self-oppression. But what, like on a practical scale, can I, as a white man living in a predominantly white neighborhood, practically speaking, what can I do to really make any kind of a difference?
I sit in this group. It's a Northside Allegheny Nonviolence Committee. I'm the only black person in that group. You know, it was started by white people, and they're trying to end the violence in the community. Now, do they have roadblocks? Yes. But they get involved. Now, I can't sit here and say that you need to do this, that, and third, or talk to this, that, and third person. It's really whatever you want to do, you can do. If you see that there's a crime being committed, or you see that there's an oppression that's being started, then you have to intervene. That's the biggest thing, is intervention. It's not saying, pull up your pants, you look stupid. No. It's deeper than that. It's sitting down having a conversation. Nobody wants to be lectured at. Nobody wants to be told what to do, but if you explain to them with history and how they can move forward, then it's beneficial. Because I don't believe that it's just black people who have to create this change, or it's just black people who just have to get involved, because that's not going to get anybody anywhere. That's going to get you to probably about 30% where you need to get. It's not going to work. So it's talking and it's having a conversation and it's being knowledgeable about what you want to say and where you want to go. Now, just talking to somebody isn't going to help unless you have a goal of where you want to go. Alyssa?
Alyssa, yeah. I don't know. I just think it's important to form your own opinion. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think the easy, like people think a lot of times the easy way out is to disagree with what your parents say or your family. And I think it's important to form your own opinion and research your own beliefs and figure out what you think is the right thing versus the wrong thing. And I think that's the easier way to help make a difference or be that change. I just think forming your own opinion is really important because I think it can help you realize.
And even with that, I mean, if I kind of went off with my parents, I'd probably be the most radical person you've ever seen in life. Probably be like I said, my dad's from 1950 in Alabama, and he grew up with a lot of racism. So I would kind of embrace that. Or if I would grow up with my mom or stuff like that, but I have my own opinion. I don't dress like most people I know. I don't think like most people that I used to interact with. So it is creating your own opinion and not being afraid to support your opinion. I've been in many arguments where I was the only one on my side. You know, it's not just trying to assimilate to the group and just kind of forming that group opinion, just kind of stand out as an individual. It's not easy standing on your own. But if you stand on your own long enough, you begin to get supporters. And people start kind of saying that we're moving in the right direction. Any other questions, comments? Just gonna go around and ask everybody one by one. Raven?
I am so happy that you came.
So why don't you raise your hand?
I don't know. I'm happy that you came. Like, I learned a lot from you. I appreciate you more better.
Because when I was in class, I was just thinking, I need to do something. I've harassed her many times, just falling to her office and just talking. And it's just one thing, the thing that started me, I just opened my mouth. Does anybody here know Dr. Griffin used to be here? I'm sure my age. but he was a professor here, and I just asked him, can I just sit in on your class? And he said, okay, well, what day you want to lecture? And that kind of started all with everything with me. From there, I started writing and getting involved. So it really just starts with just wherever you want to start, that's where you start. You just follow up with it.
You
want to
tell them about your website and contact info?
Business cards. Yeah, don't care. I think.
Oh, I should put the website.
But, Nadia, do you have any questions? I think it's Nadia, right?
Yeah, that's me.
Different things that I see. the different things I believe in, and that is
on Facebook.
Yep, there's a fan page on there. But it's, I don't know. If you go on, you can Google that. But I don't even know the website. I didn't create the website, so.
Yeah.
But I think it's like Mr. Sharif Rasheed at the onechange.wordpress.com, something along those lines.